Krista, it's so good to have you here today. We're just thrilled, both for this afternoon and this evening. So it's good
well,
to have you here.
I'm so happy to be here. I am. I've been looking forward to this. We've been planning this for a long time, right?
Yeah,
you and Lily
yeah.
started talking.
Yeah.
I did say at our table that she has very much enjoyed working with you and with everybody at Biola, and that is not a given. Lily has really high standards, and so thank you for making my life even that much happier. I'm very happy to be here, excited about tonight, and I run into Biola or Biola people all over the place. Actually, I was thinking that the Templeton program, I met someone from Biola or a couple people from Biola at a Templeton gathering a couple of years ago. We have Templeton funding also. And then, more recently, we got contacted by this rock group, the Cold War Kids. And actually, I met them someplace else, and they said, they listen to the podcast when they're on the road. And then Nathan, who I guess started Cold War Kids, was performing in Minneapolis, and he came by our studio, and that was very exciting. We talked about Biola. He was excited that we were coming here. He's a graduate. I think a couple of them are, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then dad's a professor here, too.
Okay. Yeah, and he's great. And then recently, again, I was at a church in Minneapolis, an Episcopal church, and there were a couple of Biola grads who I think were in the arts program. So you're everywhere.
Beautiful people. I'm
sure. And they're always so happy when I say, we're going to Biola.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. Well, so I want to ask you a couple questions. We'll have a conversation, and then I want to include you in the conversation as well, so you can be formulating your questions as we go. So you began your weekly national show, Speaking of Faith, uh-huh. in 2003, and I think I first heard that show maybe 2006 or so, uh-huh. years ago, and it was astonishing. Like I was in my car and I was yeah. hearing this, and I was listening to NPR.
Whatever. You're like, wait, is this really NPR?
Wait, what? What am I hearing?
Someone told me recently. They said, when I first heard this, I couldn't believe you were getting away with it. I said, I felt like that for a long time too.
Well, I kind of want to ask you about that, getting away with it. I mean, because I think what was so surprising is that I think we have such a sort of crisis of speech about
yes.
religion, faith, theology. And so it seemed perfectly fitting to me that the title of the show was Speaking of Faith, uh-huh. finding words, finding speech over against the trivializing speech about religion and faith and yeah. so on. You were hosting this really deep and profound show. You were hosting these conversations that was finding speech and over against the kind of polarizing, partisan, blood-boiling mm-hmm. Speech about religion. You were hosting really open, hospitable, genuinely mutual conversations. And so that's what really struck me. And I'm interested in how you think about that, the formulation of speech about faith in the United States today,
yeah.
and maybe how you're thinking about that has changed. Has that speech changed over the last 14 years?
A small question.
Yeah, right. You can take
well,
it with, in whatever
yeah,
direction
yeah, no,
you
no.
want.
No, no,
say
I
you
like
want.
Big questions. Yeah. So, I had been a journalist in divided Europe. I had grown up Southern Baptist, kind of left religion, never became atheist or was actively not religious. I just moved into this world where it didn't seem relevant. It was kind of, there in a closet somewhere. So it was thoroughly political, working in divided Berlin, but then started coming back to this part of myself and being curious about this religion alive in the world. And I'd been in Cold War Europe where that was not, at least overtly, any kind of factor. When I came out of, and so I went to seminary, I went to Yale Divinity School, I got an MDiv, and I came out of that in the mid-90s. And one way I think about what had happened in the mid-90s is that after a long self-imposed silence conservative Christian voices, evangelical Christian voices, had decided to insert themselves into public life. But something that happened kind of on overdrive is that a few voices really gave themselves over to political forms of speech, political ways of being heard, which in my mind really distorted often what they had to say. And I always say that it was a collusion between people who were doing that and my fellow journalists, who were very happy for them to be making for really toxic sound bites, right? Because when you shift from saying somebody is wrong to they're evil, and you do it in a sound bite, or you turn it into a sound bite, it gets dangerous. And so I had just gone to seminary. I was so, you know, and after having years of not even imagining theology to be part of the human toolkit or the human, you know, one of our great disciplines, to have discovered it as one of our great disciplines, and as carrying questions and virtues and, you know, just substantive riches that should belong in, be able to find a way in public life that was true to their depth and their wisdom. What I saw was the opposite in terms of speech about religion. And so I just got fired up with this idea that you know, I had an MDiv, I was a journalist, and that maybe I should pursue this. It was a long, rocky road, and I didn't have a background in radio, but I did think that public radio at some point, I loved radio just writ large, and I felt like public radio should be a place where you could create something that would take on this subject with these values that public radio aspires to of intelligence and balance, and that would open imaginations up rather than shutting them down. And I wanted to do something that would be true to the intellectual content of faith as well as the spiritual content of faith. And, you know, by the way, I felt that the spiritual content of faith was almost absent in a lot of the public talk. So that was my aspiration. There were mostly disbelievers, mostly skeptics. I was a guerrilla warrior. My colleagues will tell you, I still think of myself as a guerrilla warrior, and I'm really trying to work on that because it's not true anymore, but I was really comfortable with that. I was a fighter. But what happened is there were always more skeptics than there were believers, but whenever we put this stuff on the air, people responded. And people with money responded. You know, and people said, we want this. We want to be hearing this. We want to be hearing this on public radio. You know, we will donate funds to keep hearing this. And then we grew it.
Well, I mean, if you think of yourself as a guerrilla warrior, you fight elegantly. Well, it strikes me that your project has also turned into a kind of archive of this discourse over 14 years or
really,
whatever.
Yeah, really. I like the turn of the century, in this century.
Yeah.
Since the turn of the century.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in how, from that lens, or from these conversation after conversation, have you seen any kind of large shifts, changes in the ways that Americans are speaking about, or non-Americans, the world, whoever you interview? Yeah.
Speaking about faith.
Yeah, are speaking about faith, religion, theology, spirituality?
Yeah. I actually think that the atmosphere now is much more spacious and curious. I mean, I would say the atmosphere right now in particular is not very spacious or curious, and that doesn't have anything to do with faith. Yeah. But in general, I feel that there's been an opening. Even right now, you know, I think there's an opening to understanding there's a lot we don't get, and that is actually a humanizing thing. So my hope is that we can live into that humility. That awakening. President Corey and I were talking a little bit about how, you know, what I saw is, the new atheist, the kind of strident anti-faith voices, in my mind were a reaction to the way those a few voices of faith emerged and were packaged. Yeah. And the new atheists sold a lot of books in a short period of time, but I experienced them to peak pretty quickly. I mean, I know that's kind of still with us as a phenomenon, but what I've seen in the wake of that is a new conversation and interplay, even in the realm of across science, the boundaries of science and religion. And I think reason and religion. I was just interviewed by, I think it was, you know, it was a kind of hip Vox, right? And he said, this young man who was interviewing me said, you do know this, that some people are critical of you for being soft on religious voices. And then he added, he was paraphrasing somebody else, but he said, or voices of unreason is what he said. And I said, you know, well, soft, I will take that. Yeah. But soft doesn't mean that you're not thinking clearly.
Yeah.
And, you know, one thing I've insisted from the beginning, also with my fellow journalists, is that if you want to understand people and perspectives of faith, you know, one thing journalists have trouble with is they'll say, well, this is not an objective part of life. And I've said, that's right. So I have to honor the subjectivity, get close to that. But by the way, haven't we figured out recently that economics and politics aren't objective empirical pursuits either? Right? And so I actually think one thing that has happened with 2008, with our political, you know, drama, is that we're understanding how complicated we are. And in a funny way, it's opening people up to these parts of life. And faith is, religion is the part of life that has really honored and interrogated and across generations conversed about how complex we are and the complex matter of rising to our best selves and who we are to each other. And those questions, for many reasons, are now right out on the surface of our life together.
Well, and it strikes me that part of what you've been doing is advocating that knowing something, learning something, having discoveries together, very much depends on who you are and what sort of virtues you're bringing to the project. You mentioned humility. That I'll read something that you wrote in your most recent book. I noticed that in both Speaking of Faith and in the most recent book, Becoming Wise, you end both books with a meditation on humility. I mean, both books are really about virtues, public virtues. But
did I really? Is the humility part near the end of Speaking of Faith?
Yeah,
I forgot that.
Yeah, very end.
Yeah. Interesting.
And so here's what you wrote about humility in the most recent book. Spiritual humility is not about getting small, not about debasing oneself, but about approaching everything and everyone else with a readiness to see goodness and to be surprised. This is the humility of a child, which Jesus lauded. It's the humility of the scientist and the mystic. It has a lightness of step, not a heaviness of heart. It's very beautiful. I love it. I think what you're advocating there is it's right to talk about reason, logic, what's true, but it's important for us to talk about who we are in these projects of knowing, and there are certain virtues that actually tie the mystic and the scientist and the child together.
Yes, and I love the language of virtue and the whole notion of virtues, and I work with that a lot. And I think you're right that it runs through almost everything, whether it's being discussed overtly or not. I do experience that millennials, younger people are really attracted to the language of virtues. And every once in a while I say that in a room that has, I don't know, maybe especially Catholics, like older Catholics in it, and they experience this to be really oppressive language. Like it's about rules that you were probably breaking whether you knew it or not. Probably my grandfather would have felt that way about it too. But I think to me, virtue is this is this practicality, these tools for living, that take in a very astute and sophisticated view of the human condition and work with that. And but I guess the reason what I'm saying at the end of the book is that it's a lightness of step, not a heaviness of heart. These are not things that are foisted on us. You know, it's not like eat your spinach, although spinach is now in. But you know, whatever. It's not. These are ways to live that are better and more joyful.
And lead to real knowing.
Yes.
It's a wisdom. That you're after. Maybe I'll ask you one more question, and then we'll open it up for questions from you all. So Biola is an evangelical Christian institution, which means that we've devoted ourselves to thinking and speaking and exploring our disciplines, whatever they might be, specifically within the framework of the traditions of Christian thought and practice. And in some ways, that's maybe a narrowing of the discourse of faith, religion, spirituality that happens here. I'm interested in, from your point of view, what are the kind of problems and possibilities, maybe possibilities especially, this project here. Maybe what I'm after is, how should we hope for our project of Biola here? This project of Christian liberal arts education.
Yeah.
Is that another big question?
Yeah, huge. I would never say it's a narrowing.
Yeah.
I would say it's a deepening. I feel like something that went really wrong in the 60s, which is when I was born. I was born in 1960. And when we experienced diversity at a new level culturally in America, and not just, I mean, you know, back then it was radical for Catholics and Protestants to talk to each other, so that was interfaith. But it was religious diversity, it was ethnic diversity, you know, with the 1965 Immigration Act. I mean, we really did truly at every level, and socially, there was a diversity of ways to think about what it meant to be a woman or a citizen, or right? So. But the way we did that was to enshrine tolerance, which to me is a very limiting word, way too small from a Christian perspective or any kind of religious perspective. The meaning of tolerance in the medical lexicon is about the limits of thriving in an unfavorable environment. I wouldn't have chosen to have all these other people around, but I'm going to do what I can to stay in the room or to let them stay in the room. And you know, that's kind of how we've structured workplaces and schools, and it hasn't been sustainable. It hasn't been good for us. So I think there's this great irony of this moment that it's becoming clearer that whatever our particularity is, that is our gift to the world. And I think that's true in every way. I certainly think it's true of a Christian liberal arts institution. It's that deep knowing. It's that groundedness. It's what you actually have to share. And I think, again, that the young among us are kind of growing up in this world of plurality. And, you know, shaking their heads at the idea that they're supposed to somehow make a choice between being a good citizen of the world and living peaceably and creatively with different others and being deeply who they are and having convictions and seeking truth, which we are called to do as human beings. So in that sense, you know, so, but I do think this is a new, that's not the way we've done it up to now. We did make it kind of an either or. And then that's also why, you know, the model was then like when conservative Christian voices burst out of their box and said, we're not going to stay in this compartment. There wasn't really a way to do that. But that's what we're trying to, I think we're all walking this ground. Can we be diverse and deep at the same time? It's so interesting. There's so many analogies. This is happening on so many levels that are very confusing right now. Like, you know, globalization means that, and you know, the technologies that have made that possible, the connectedness that makes that possible, means that for the very first time in the history of our species, we are equipped. This is huge, to think and act like a species, as a species. But at the same time, something that is bubbling up in all kinds of ways, both generative and destructive, is that this is not making the power of the local go away. It's making it more important. Identity is not becoming less important and powerful. It's becoming more important again. So I see this challenge as, you know, a microcosm of that one. But also I want to say not just a microcosm. I think, I think an institution like Biola has so much to offer to the world in this moment of flux and confusion and fear, in the depths of your tradition, to speak directly to that and to speak to virtue and to hope. So that's my kind of long-winded answer.
Good. Thank you. I'm interested in questions from the audience or comments from the audience. And we have, Brian, do we have a microphone going around? I can give mine away too if anyone up close. Anyone? Yeah.
Identify yourself too, Chris.
I'm Chris Davidson in the English department. Thank you for coming, Krista. This may be a very tiny question, but I think it might touch on a larger idea. It feels tiny. But one of the things that I've noticed as a subscriber to On Being is that you each week release both the edited version and the unedited version. And yeah. I'm just interested in that practice because no other podcast that I subscribe to does that.
Yeah.
And I don't know how that touches on your philosophy of the show or your understanding of how people should be understood or how construction both gives us access to and limits or something. I don't know. So. Mm-hmm. However you want to answer.
It's a good question. And our colleague, Trent Gillis, who's not with us today, that was his idea. And he created our digital presence, which really is has a human touch to it. And it took him about 2 years to convince me and the rest of the production team that we should release that. And now it has become really essential to how we think of ourselves. I mean, his argument at the time was, two things. He said, there's so many interesting things in these conversations that end up on the cutting room floor, and it's a shame that nobody can hear them. It's very messy. Like the 90 minutes, the raw 90 minutes, I mean, it's messy on purpose because, you know, what I'm going to do tonight is not going to be messy like that. So it's a different discipline to do a live conversation. That space is I'm going to be much more in control. but when I'm doing 90 minutes and I'm in a studio and they're coming into my headphones and I know we're going to have to lose, we cut it down, it becomes like 52 minutes of a produced show, so about 45 minutes of an interview. I can let them, and in a real conversation, somebody walks down a road and I am thinking to myself, this is probably not going to lead anywhere. Or I'm thinking to myself, they really need to say this. This is really important for them to say, I know it's not going to make the finished show for whatever reason. But often, you know, it's worth doing also because sometimes they walk down that road and then there's this jewel at the end and we would never have gotten there if we didn't take that route. But it's, you know, again, it's not a neat, tidy experience that I'm curating for the listener. So that's one thing, that there are things in there worth hearing. But I think the deeper point was that if we really believe this stuff we say about transparency as a value, and that is a value that culturally, especially younger people, hold, then we should put our money where our mouth is, and we should just put it out there. You know, it's there are like 400,000 people a month who listen to that unedited interview. And that amazes me. And I think maybe the first two times we did it, and I thought, oh my God, this unedited is going to be on the air. I thought about it, and I'd never think about it anymore. I ramble too. But one thing that's been interesting to me about putting the unedited on the air is it does engender trust. I mean, Trent was right about that. And we've also heard from high school teachers who will play for their students when they're assigning the show in classes. They'll play that first 5 minutes where we're doing the sound check. Chris meets people who say, oh, you're Chris, because always I'm saying, Chris, what do you need from us? Right? Chris, are we okay to go? And what did you have for breakfast? But for younger people, knowing that we've put that messiness out there makes it a trustworthy space. That's very interesting.
I am so glad you're here. I am a groupie. I'm a huge groupie. I listen to you. I'll try to control myself. My name is Mike Longino. I teach journalism here at Biola. Mm. And I began listening to you when I lived in Kentucky. I was teaching another institution in central Kentucky. And so I try to teach my students to be willing to understand the other, especially when that person is radically different and with whom you disagree. So what I refer them to is an interview between Terry Gross and Larry Flint. And this has gone way, way, way years back. And, you know, Terry Gross, furthest from agreeing with what Larry Flint stands for, but she invited him in because she wanted her listeners to hear, to get inside the mind of a pornographer. Mm-hmm. And she just put that out there. So in your selection of people that you talk to, I guess I'm asking, how do you bring yourself across the microphone with someone with whom you disagree mm-hmm. about spiritual things or about their perspective, and select questions that will help people understand their mind, mm-hmm. but in a sense, not align yourself with something you disagree with? So just to put that out there.
Well, I'm in a different situation. I'm in a very privileged situation in a sense, because Terry has a daily show and they're following the news. And so for her to say, we're gonna understand the mind of a pornographer, it belongs in that, and we don't have to do that. We bring people on the air who we think are people of lives of wisdom and grace, who getting to know that these people are in the world, hearing how they live, how they think, is going to model something and be practically useful and be nourishing. And you know, we also go light on famous people, which is also, you know, and that's, it's just, you know, the easy way to grow a podcast now is have famous people on, have celebrities on. And we do celebrities occasionally, but what I think another thing we're really committed to in terms of who we choose to be on are people who are, you know, below the radar, which is most everybody. But the thing is, you know, so I have somebody like Walter Brueggemann on, or we just had Eugene Peterson on. So anybody who's gone to seminary for the last 30 years has read Eugene Peterson, probably in any Christian tradition. But if you haven't, you've probably never heard of him. And so we love introducing actually very influential voices in our world who've nourished many lives, but you haven't heard of them because they're not famous in this traditional way. That's a huge... So I am in the... So it's not that I agree with everybody that I interview, and obviously many of them have a very different... come from a very different place. But I honor them. I'm glad they exist. I want to understand how they became the way they are, and I believe they have wisdom to share.
For someone who hasn't heard your show before, do you have any recommendations where they should start? Which interview should they start with? Or,
well, I think our all-time greatest hit is the Irish philosopher, poet, theologian, Irish blatherer, John O'Donohue. You've heard that one? I mean, it kind of has everything in it. And I meet people who tell me that they keep that on their iPod, they listen to it once a month or once a year, or they've heard it 55 times. I don't quite understand what it is about that show. We did a show actually just last week with Alain de Botton, who started the School of Life in London. He's a philosopher. And it was about love. What do we call it? The true hard work of love and relationships. I kind of think that one over time is going to rival John O'Donohue. It's what we all wish we'd heard before we got married. And I think one of the tweets I liked most when that show was on the air was this woman writing saying, you know, she wrote, it was one of these silly tweets where they have people jumping up and down. I never do that. But, you know, she's like jumping up. She said, when you realize your kid is listening to On Being, which, you know, she wrote, and she said, I'm a single mother of a 17-year-old young man, and he was riveted by this, and, you know, how wonderful. Because it was, and I mean, talk about, you know, a virtue that, in fact, is very complex in the tradition, but very superficial in the culture. And yet, it's something we all engage in. And it is what makes us human as much as anything else. And it was just a really, really rich conversation about the reality of love and the reality of long-term love and the reality of how there are many kinds of love in our lives. And we even got into things like how, this is a big topic of mine right now, that we have a lot of intelligence in our private lives that we could apply to our public life to benefit. For example, that humiliating somebody you love is not the way to help them change for the better. And I feel like that's, you know, we could stop and say to ourselves in public, yeah, political life for now, you know, humiliating the other side or trying to is not going to get any kind of result, any kind of good human result.
Other than more humiliation.
Yeah, she's going to make us all, it's going to set us back.
Self-humiliation often,
Is there anybody else? Anybody else?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. First of all, I'm delighted you had Peterson on recently. Anyway.
He was so poetic, too.
Well, he is,
so
isn't he?
Much about how he reads the Bible as poetry.
No, so many of his titles are poetic lines, right? Yeah. Christ plays in 10,000 places.
Yeah.
So that's great. You know, I listen to your podcast and I think, okay, how can I ask questions like her? And so, I mean, I'm trying to piece it together, but you could just really help me. Just tell me. So let's face it, the art of asking questions is an art, and it's a lovely one. But wow, is it filled with a lot of experience to get that place. So, and again, probably for you it's very organic. But how would you say, you know, these are the questions that I aim at, or this is what I'm trying to do with my questions. Mm-hmm. So wherever you want crib note it for
it
us.
It is an art. And also what I want to say about that is that it's worth us taking questioning seriously as an art that should be cultivated and appreciated. And we don't. We like really deal in answers. But it's also a skill. It's a practice. And so I am so much better. I mean, I'm just worlds better at this now than I was 10 years ago because I've just done it and done it and done it and done it. I call my, Lily and I were yesterday at Paramount Pictures because we were meeting with Jill Soloway, who's doing that show, Transparent. This is a long story. But We stood outside the Gene Roddenberry house and got our picture taken. It was very exciting. Because I call my interview preparation approach the Vulcan mind meld approach to interview preparation, which is, but I, you know, this is something like I've done it a lot, and then at some point I started to understand what I was doing. So, you know, I don't just sit down and ask good questions. I do a huge amount of preparation because I take it seriously. And I consider the asking of good questions and the creation of a conversational space, which includes the fact that I walk in prepared as an act of hospitality. And it's also an act of hospitality that's going to improve what happens in the space. So it's pragmatic in that sense, too. But when I say the Vulcan mind meld thing, I think what I try to do with help is just understand. I mean, if people have written books, I will read their books. Or if, you know, you can learn so much about somebody online now. But we also look at any other questions and answer sessions they've done, other interviews they've done, and I think that what I realized a few years ago, what I'm coming away with, is I'm trying not just to understand what they know or what they do, but how they think. And if you have a sense of how somebody thinks, first of all, that communicate. And if you've taken the care, the time and the care, right? I mean, we all have, this is a very ordinary experience. You know what it is to sit down with somebody who you're just meeting, and you know within seconds if you're gonna spend your time defending or explaining yourself, and it will be trying, and you have to be guarded. Or you know within seconds if somebody gets you. And if you sit down with somebody who gets you, your whole body relaxes. And the course of the conversation will be different. I mean, if I think about, you know, I think a couple of very quick tips. I mean, where you start a conversation is absolutely critical. Everything goes from there. And I do believe, as I said, that this presence of hospitality communicates itself before words are spoken. So coming into the room genuinely curious, is it not just pretending to be curious or even asking really good questions that convey curiosity, because that also communicates itself. So you have to muster, really figure out what do you have to do inside yourself, especially if these are complicated people, to be genuinely curious, which does not mean that you're going in ready for them to change you or convert you to their side, but it does mean that you would like to be surprised by them. You're willing to be surprised. And actually, we're not trained in this culture to walk into, to meet strangers, especially strangers with deep convictions, and be ready to be surprised. So that's like an orientation. And then I think, you know, a question, starting out with a question that also takes people into a less presentational part of themselves. So the question I ask so much is about the religious or spiritual background of your childhood. And everybody actually, most everybody has a really interesting answer to that. But the main reason that is the question is because it just plants people in a place in themselves that is soft and searching and full of questions. And it's an interesting place for, you know, if you take somebody to an interesting place, then they forget that they're being interviewed. And you're just together. Another question that I'm sharing a lot these days that is just hugely important and just could not be simpler is, you know, we're so triggered by language now, by words. And we have so many words floating around that are just loaded down with connotations, so that the minute somebody utters them, you know, I know exactly who you are. And just to, especially if people use words that are problematic for you, for whatever reason, to ask with genuine curiosity. Now, first of all, take a breath, but then say, tell me what that word means when you use it. And really what you're asking is, you know, we walk into every room and every conversation with our entire lives, right? And so really when you're asking that, you're asking, tell me something about, you know, the story of your life that led you to, you know, use that word in this way. And then I can see you as a human being, even if I continue to disagree with you, and something different will be possible.
It seems to run so counter to the ways that we do journalism these days.
Yeah, because journalistic questions are often performance.
Yeah, performance.
And they're often about the how the journalist sounds. Yeah. And they're, in fact, designed to catch. So you create this defensive atmosphere where nothing revealing. If something may happen that's titillating, but nothing truly revealing is going to happen.
And we'll wrap up. I was a Bible scholar recently told me that if you look at the Gospels, Jesus is asked something like 130 or so, some odd questions, and he answers only 8 of them. Hmm. But he asks something like 380 questions of other people.
Right, I love that, yeah.
Jesus as questioner.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being with us this afternoon.
It has been a real joy.
Biola University prepares Christians to think biblically about everything, from science to business to education and the arts. Learn more at biola.edu.